Classes are like blueprints. You can create multiple houses with one blueprint. With classes, we can create multiple copies of an object. For classes, we're going to use a library called Classic. I put a link in the description. Click on classic.lua, click on raw, copy all of the code and paste it in a new file. Save the file as classic.lua. In main.lua, we put object equals require classic. Now that we have the class library ready, let's make a class. Create a new file called rectangle.lua. At the top we put rectangle equals object extend. Let's write a colon, not a dot. I will explain everything, but let's finish creating this class first. Below we create a function called rectangle.new. I forgot how to explain this in the object tutorial, but this is how we give an object a function. As parameter we add self. Inside the function we say that self.test equals met.random 0, 1000. We just created a class. A few more steps and I can start explaining. Of course, we need to require the file first, require rectangle. After, we say that r1 equals rectangle. That's right, we call rectangle. And do the same for r2. r2 equals rectangle. And lastly, print r1.test and r2.test. Run the game and you'll see that two random numbers are printed. So what was all that just now? Let's start in rectangle.lua. We say that rectangle equals object extend. With this, we create a new class called rectangle. This will be our blueprint. As opposed to properties, class names are normally written with an uppercase character. Go back to main.lua. We say that r1 equals rectangle. Even though rectangle is an object, the library classic allows us to call it as a function. I might explain how someday. But the point is that when we call rectangle, it creates a new instance. What that means is that it takes our blueprint and creates an object that has all the class's features. To prove that r1 is unique, we create another instance of rectangle, r2. r1 and r2 are two different objects, because r1.test is not the same as r2.test. When we call rectangle, it executes rectangle.new. This is what we call the constructor, something every class needs to have. The parameter self is the instance we're modifying. If we were to say that rectangle.test equals met.random 0,500, then r1 would never have the property test, because we give the property to rectangle and not to an instance of rectangle. In other words, we give the property to the blueprint and not to what we create with our blueprint. Let's expand our class. Create two more functions, rectangle.update and rectangle.draw. Don't forget the self parameter and add a delta time parameter to update. Copy the code of creating our rectangle in main.lua to the rectangle.new function and replace rectangle with self. Copy the code of the rectangle moving to rectangle.update and copy the code of drawing the rectangle to rectangle.draw. Replace v with self in both functions. Remove all the code of rectangles in main.lua. We'll only be using r1 and r2 for now. In love.update, type r1.update, r1, delta time. And in love.draw, type r1.draw, r1. Run the game. You'll see our rectangle is moving. So again, we made a class. We call rectangle and it gives us a copy of the class. This is what we call an instance. So our instance r1 now has the functions update and draw as well. In love.update, we call r1.update with the arguments r1 and delta time. The first argument we pass, r1, is what self is in the function. But it's kind of annoying how we need to pass our instance every time we call one of its functions. Luckily, Lua has a shorthand. If we replace the dot with a colon, it will automatically pass the object left of the colon as first argument. We can do this with the creation of the function as well. If we replace the dot of rectangle.new with a colon, we don't need to add the self parameter. Do this for update and draw as well. In rectangle.new, I still say .new, but just because it's easier to say it like that. Anyway, in rectangle.new, we're going to add some parameters. X, Y, width, and height. And replace all the properties with their corresponding parameters. So, self.x equals x, self.y equals y, etc. Change speed back to 100 instead of a random value. When creating R1, pass some numbers as arguments. 100, 20, 50, 300. Do the same for R2 and make sure they're different numbers. 150, 300, 250, 40. And make sure to call r2.update and r2.draw as well. Run the game. You can now see that we created two unique rectangles. This is what makes classes so great. Both rectangles work exactly the same, but at the same time, they're unique. Another thing that makes classes great is inheritance. Let's say we're making Super Mario Brothers. We create a class for a Goomba and a class for a Koopa. A Goomba and a Koopa are two different enemies, but they share some features. For example, when they collide with a wall, it will turn the opposite way. A very simple feature, but something that has to be programmed. So we program that a Goomba bounces off a wall and copy the code and paste it in our Koopa class. This is bad, because we repeat that piece of code. If we ever make a change to the code in the Goomba class, we also have to change it in the Koopa class. Repeating code is something you should always try to avoid. Here's where inheritance comes in. We create what we call a base class. In this class, we put the code that will be used in both the Goomba and the Koopa class. So for example, we create a base class called enemy and tell it what to do when it collides with a wall. Now we create a Goomba class, but instead of typing object.extend, we type enemy.extend. This means that the Goomba class is an extension of the enemy class. The enemy class is our base and we're building on top of it. Whatever we do with the Goomba class does not affect the enemy class. We basically made a copy of the enemy blueprint and we're drawing on top of that blueprint. We do the same for Koopa. So now Goomba and Koopa both have the base class enemy. And they both have the wall bouncing feature. If you ever need to change the wall bouncing code, we only need to do it once and it will affect both the Goomba and the Koopa. Let's create a base class for rectangle. We're going to name it shape. Give it a constructor, and inside the constructor, we give it an x and y property. Move rectangle.update to the shape class. Don't forget to replace rectangle with shape. We don't give it a draw function. Now we make a rectangle class extend the shape class. Inside rectangle's constructor, we need to call shape's constructor by ourselves. We do this with rectangle.super.new self. This is how we call a function of our base class, also known as super class. Rectangle.super is the class we extended, so rectangle.super.new is the function new for our superclass. We have to pass self as first argument because we don't call it as the instance. Of course, we can pass arguments to this function. In this case, we want to pass the x and y our constructor receives. So now we can remove self.x and self.y. The shape class already does this. Let's make another class called circle. To save time, copy the code of the rectangle class. First, replace all the rectangles to circle. Remove the width and height. Circles don't have a width and height. They have a radius. So self.radius equals radius. And add a radius parameter. And of course, we need to replace the draw function with drawing a circle. So love.graphics.circle, line, self.x, self.y, self.radius, and 50. The 50 is the number of segments, not really important for now. Require the new classes we created, and instead of R2 equals rectangle, we're going to say R2 equals circle. Now when we run the game, you'll see we both have a rectangle and a circle. So that's it for classes. I know it's very confusing, but like everything else, you'll get it eventually. Now that you know how classes work, it's time to use everything we learned to create a game. Thanks for watching.